Let's discuss the concept of strain deviator and its invariance. Similar concept we have seen in the chapter analysis of stress. Let's begin with a state of strain matrix Eij, and we can resolve this strain matrix into two components like this, where the strain E denotes mean of normal strains epsilon x, epsilon y and epsilon z, where strain E represents mean elongation or mean strain at a point. So this is a state of strain corresponding to a coordinate system, and this matrix is known as pure shear state of strain, pure shear state of strain, or it is also known as deviatoric strain. Application of this type of strain on a parallel pipid or any type of element results in deformation in shape, but the volume of that element remains same. So there will not be any volumetric strain if we apply pure shear state of strain or deviatoric strain. Here we have calculated the volumetric strain by adding the normal strain components, and this summation produced zero value. Now let's take the other matrix. This is known as hydrostatic state of strain or spherical part of strain matrix or isotropic state of strain. If you apply this type of strain on a body, then you will see that the body has contracted or expanded. In many books and articles, this type of deformation is termed as distortion, and this type of deformation is termed as dilatation. Compatibility conditions. This condition is also known as continuity equations. To understand this condition, let's discuss about the relationship between strain components and displacement fields having component ux, uy and uz. These relationships are derived from six Cauchy's strain displacement equations. All these equations are written over here. So corresponding to three displacement components ux, uy and uz, we get six equations. Therefore, all the six strain components cannot be prescribed independently. There must exist some relationship among them. Let's talk about these three strain components. So these three components of a strain are derived from ux and uy. That means we can't arbitrarily prescribe values to epsilon x, epsilon y and gamma xy independently. There must be some relationship which constrain the values of these three strain components. Same condition apply for any set of strain components. Some people ask that if there are six strain equations for three displacement components, then can we get different displacement fields at a point? Once set of ux, uy and uz determined from these three equations, and another set of ux, uy and uz from these three equations. So can we get different displacement fields at a point corresponding to these two different set of equations? So in this concept of compatibility, we will try to answer this question, and we will try to derive a relationship that will constrain the six strain components by a certain relation. This statement can also be explained with this example. Suppose I have a strain matrix like this, and I have assigned the value of gamma xy, gamma xz, and gamma yz, these values. Let's substitute. So can we assign any arbitrary value to gamma yx, gamma zx, and gamma zy? Can we assign any arbitrary value to this strain component, this strain component, and this strain component? The answer is obviously not. This is a straightforward answer. But what about this question? This is a very serious question. And here it is asked that can we assign any arbitrary value to epsilon x, epsilon y, and epsilon z? Can we assign any arbitrary value to this and this strain component? The answer is not. We cannot assign any arbitrary value to these strain components. To derive the compatibility condition, we will group the six Cauchy's strain displacement equation into two groups. The first group consists of these three strain equations, and the second group consists of these three strain equations. Let's start with the first group of strain equations. In the first group, we will take linear strain and we will try to derive shear strain from these linear strain components. So first of all, let's differentiate the first two of the above equations as follows. So we will differentiate these two equations, and finally we will get these two differential equations. If we add these two equations, then we will get this third equation. This part denotes the shear strain in xy plane. So in right hand side, we finally get this expression. So our final equation will be dou square epsilon xx by dou y square plus this thing is equal to dou square gamma xy by dou x dou y. Similarly, we can derive the relationship between epsilon yy, epsilon zz, and gamma yz, and epsilon zz, epsilon xx, and gamma zx. So these three equations suggest that corresponding to any set of linear strain components, we will get a unique set of gamma xy, gamma yz, and gamma zx. Now let's take second group, where we have gamma xy is equal to this part, gamma yz is equal to this relationship, and gamma xz is equal to this relationship of displacement components. Now if we differentiate these three equations, then we get these expressions. Now if we add these two equations and subtract this one, then we get this type of equation. Then let's differentiate the above equation once more with respect to z, and resulting equation will take this form. Now it is clear that dou uz by dou z can be written as epsilon z. So finally we get this equation. Similarly, we can derive two more equations in this form. And these three equations suggest that for any value of shear strain, gamma yz, gamma zx, and gamma xy, okay, you will get a unique set of epsilon z, epsilon x, and epsilon y. So these are the six compatibility equations, and these six equations are popularly known as Saint-Venant's equations of compatibility. Now let's solve one problem. And in this problem, it is given that the system of strain is a function of x and y, and these are written over here. All the z component are zero. That means it is a planar system of strain. So we have to determine whether this system of strain is possible or not. And if it is possible, then we have to find out. Then we have to find out the expressions of displacement components ux, uy, and uz. Let's solve it and try to obtain this answer. So we know the compatibility equations, and the first three compatibility equations are written over here. So if we consider the first equation, so first of all we have to take differentiation of epsilon x, and after taking double differentiation we will get this dou square epsilon xx by dou y square will be equal to 2 plus 12 y square. Correct? And this dou square epsilon y by dou x square will be equal to 6 plus 12 x square. And dou square gamma xy by dou y will be equal to, so this dou square gamma xy by dou x dou y is equal to 12 x square plus 12 y square plus 8. So left hand side is 2 plus 6, that means 8 plus 12 y square plus 12 x square. And in the right hand side, we are getting the same expression. So that means the first equation is satisfied. Now come to the second equation. In the second equation, we have to take double differentiation of epsilon yy. So if we take double differentiation of, so if we differentiate epsilon y with respect to z, we will get 0. And this differentiation also gives 0. And if you take differentiation of this quantity, then again you will get 0. So in the left hand side you have 0, and in the right hand side you again have 0. So overall the system, so this equation is satisfied. Now the third equation. The first component of this equation will be 0. Second component of this equation will also be 0. And the third term of this equation will also be 0. So left hand side and right hand side are equal. That means this third equation is also satisfied. Now we will test the remaining three equations of compatibility. And it is clear that in, since epsilon z is 0, so right hand side is going to become 0. And again, if you take differentiation with respect to z, then again you are going to finally get 0. So left hand side and right hand side are 0, so this equation is satisfied. Similarly, this gamma yz is 0, gamma zx is 0. And if you take differentiation of gamma xy with respect to z, then again you will get 0. So overall this part is 0. And we know that if we take differentiation with respect to z, then we will get 0. So right and left part are 0. That means equation is satisfied. Finally, consider this third equation. In this third equation, we know that gamma zx is 0, gamma yz is also 0, and if you take differentiation with respect to z, then you will get 0. So this whole left part is 0, and again if you take differentiation with respect to z, then you will get 0. So all these six equations are satisfied. That means this system of strain is possible. Next, we have to find out the expression of ux and uy. And we know that epsilon x is equal to dou ux over dou x. So to find out ux, we will take integration. And if we integrate this expression of epsilon x, then we will get what? We will get 5x plus x cube by 3 plus xy square plus x5 by 5 plus xy to the power 4 plus a constant. So with respect to x, y is also a constant. So we can write down cy, because c is a constant, that is obvious. But with respect to x, y is also a constant. So if we are integrating epsilon x with respect to x, then this constant term may include y also, because y is independent of x. Similarly, if we integrate this epsilon y with respect to y, then we will get u y. It is also asked that the displacement equation of u x and u y should satisfy the condition that the displacement and rotation at the origin are 0. So at the origin, x we have to put as 0, and y should also be 0. So it is very clear that if we put x is equal to 0 and y is equal to 0, then ux will become 0 and uy also will be 0. Next, we have to prove that rotation at the origin is also 0 if we consider this as the displacement field. We know that rotation is obtained by taking half of the dou uy by dou x minus dou ux by dou y. So if we take partial derivative of uy with respect to x, and if we take partial derivative of ux with respect to y, and we subtract them and take, and if we put x is equal to 0 and y is equal to 0, we will get half c minus c, which is equal to 0. So it is clear that the displacement and rotation at the origin are 0. Now let's consider another case, which is a case of plane state of strain. So in the situation of plane state of strain, the z component of strain, that are epsilon z, gamma yz and gamma zx, are taken as 0. So what will be our state of strain at a point in case of plane state of strain? This epsilon z will be 0, gamma yz will be 0, gamma xz will also be 0, and this gamma yz and gamma xz, they will be 0. So in plane state of strain, we consider only these four strains as non-zero. Then what will be the formula of strain in a direction PQ? So this equation epsilon PQ is equal to these terms will be reduced. Now this term will be 0, this term will also be 0, this will also become 0. So finally, we will get epsilon PQ is equal to epsilon x nx square plus epsilon y ny square plus epsilon xy nx into ny. Then what will be the formula of cubical dilatation? The volumetric strain will be calculated only by taking summation of epsilon x and epsilon y. This epsilon z will become 0. How we will find the principal strains and their directions? In that case, exz will be 0, eyz will be 0, epsilon z will be 0, ezy will be 0, ezx will also be 0. That means this nz will be 0. So this will be our resulting equation. We will get only two simultaneous equations. That means we will find only epsilon 1. That means we will find only epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. Only two principal strains in case of plane state of strain. Thank you so much for your kind attention. For further detail on these covered topics, you can refer these two books, which are very popular in field of mechanics of deformable bodies or advanced mechanics of solids.